Greetings in the name of Jesus Christ, the living God. So this is part two of the spiritual warfare, the meaning behind your words, I guess, or like the spiritual warfare in light of your words. So I'm going to summarize quickly the first one. The first one, I gave you very basic ideas of the power of your words as being born in the image of God and how God created everything through his words. There was no existence until God said something, right? Then there was an existence for us to exist in. And while the existence was happening, God spoke things within it so it could come, like the trees be the light, you know, the waters, the this, the that, whatever else, right? So we are in the image of God. So the things that we say is actually much more powerful than what we actually believe or what we initially might believe, right? So typically speaking, the world already understands this. That's why they say, oh, you know, look in the mirror every single day and say, I am this or I am that, or I want to be this or I want to be that, or I'm already this or I'm already that. So then it literally scientifically proven changes your brain chemistry and makes new neurological pathways so that you can act in the way that what you're saying, right? And in the Bible, it says like out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So when you speak, you're showing reflections of what's in your heart, right? So little mini reflections here and there. So getting to the spiritual warfare part, I had to listen to the video again to see what part I needed to kind of like up on. Like the last 10 minutes are like the meat of it. I just had to like build up to it. So now I'm going to expand on the last little 10 minutes and give you more of like the spiritual warfare part. So when it comes to your words, life and death is within the tongue, the Bible says, and cursing and blessing also is within your tongue. So if you say something like, this person will never be this, or oh, I'm always stupid, or I'm always this, you're literally binding something in the spirit realm. And then kind of like when you speak it, your brain rewires itself to it so that you start acting in that way. If a child is told his or her whole life, oh, they're always shy, oh, they're always lazy, oh, they're always this, oh, they're always that, then literally they could be 40 or 50 still acting in that way because of the thing that was spoken into their life. Now, that's very basic things that everyone in the world can see the effects of, even if you don't actually understand it, right? That's why worldwide gurus are saying, like, look in the mirror and say positive things, think positively. So now, in terms of spiritual warfare, I'm going to bump it up a little bit from the last video. So in terms of spiritual warfare, the spirit realm is run in terms of like agreements, right? And these agreements are in words, right? So like, for example, in the book of Job in the Old Testament, right? Like Satan and God had a conversation. They exchanged words. Oh, God is like, hey, look at my guy. This is just a modern day, you know, summarizing of it. I'm not actually, you know, condoning. This is like verbatim the translation. So go back and read these things. If I reference something, go back and cross-reference it. Read it for yourself so you're not just taking every little thing I say true. I'm human. Sometimes I say things that I don't mean, or later on I'll find out, oh, dang, like, That was like partially true, but it wasn't the whole thing, right? So always go back and double check what I say. So like in the story of Job in the Old Testament, God basically, like the sons of God present themselves to God. Satan's along with him. Hey, Satan, what are you up to? I'm just going back and forth on earth. Then he's like, have you considered Job, my servant? He's humble. He's lowly. He's perfect. He's upright. And he shuns evil, right? And Satan was like, ah, well, he only loves you because he gave you a lot of stuff, or because you gave him a lot of stuff. Take that away and then it should be good, right? And then as we know, like the story of Job, he had testing after testing, his whole family, all his wealth, all the stuff. His wife even basically like, ah, screw you, I'm out of here, basically, right? So when what happened there, it was an agreement that God gave Satan that he can do up to a certain point, right? So Satan could do all this, but don't do this. And then he comes back again. Ah, well, you know, so I guess he does love you or whatever. But if you do this, then he'll definitely curse you, right? Notice that Satan was talking about cursing, right? Cursing. He wanted Job to curse God, right? So God allowed that to happen. But God, in his in his wisdom and knowledge that is so deep that no one can truly understand it completely, he gave permission to Satan by his words, you can do this, right? So listen. So when you, now we're going to talk about like the more deep rooted spiritual things that could happen to someone, the more, not just like, oh, someone's always shy for the rest of their life, or someone's always this, like literally there are people that will go in and out of marriages, marry, divorce. And it's not just them, right? And later on down the line, somewhere down the line, their niece, their nephew, their son, their daughter, their granddaughter, their great uncle, their whatever, right? Somewhere down the line. Now, this might literally, it's crazy. It might be only on the mother's side, right? Like there's just a line of people. They always get married and divorced, maybe two or three times on average, right? And then maybe in the father's line, somebody always dies young, right? Like these are literal curses that are in some people's lives and in your blood, right? It's in your blood. It's inside of you, right? Because now a curse does not necessarily have to be something that you spoke over your life. Somebody else, right? A wizard or witch or whoever that operates through Satan can put a curse into your life, right? And then all of a sudden you start getting into accidents unfrequently or unusually frequent, right? Like these are actual things that happen to real people. You might not hear about it, but that doesn't mean it's not true, right? So like people, they get into the curse that is within them that was spoken somehow, some way by you, another person, by Satan, an agreement that you made. It gets even drastic. Literally, people die, right? There's people that have like numerous miscarriages. Right. This is one thing. There's curses that happen where in my example, I heard voices and saw things. Now I don't, because they got casted out in Jesus' name. Right. These spirits. Right. So when the word is said, notice going back to Job, when the word was said, then the gates was opened for Satan to do whatever he could do up to a certain point. Right. But it wasn't done without a word first. This is in the heavens. This is not on earth. Job did not know anything that was going on in heaven, right? He's over here like, bro, God, what did I do, right? But nevertheless, right, God later on was faithful to show him, you know, okay, this and this happened for this and this reason, right? So now the words were said by God and Satan. It came to an agreement, and then boom, then it could actually be done. Just like the spirit realm, cursing and blessing can be done in the same way, right? So when you or someone else or a wizard or somebody that is in the evils or somebody that's in good, you can bind things or loose things in heaven if you are a born again believer in communion with Christ, right? Now you can use the name of Jesus for like, there's literal people that they don't actually believe in Jesus. They literally do not confess to be a Christian, but they know the name of Jesus works. Listen, they know the name of Jesus works, so they use it. Like these are like people that like are like sorcerers and stuff like that, and like palm readers, mystics and stuff like that, right? Like they literally use the name of Jesus, literally, okay? I don't care if you believe this stuff. You can go cross-reference these things yourself, okay? Just go cross-reference it. And if you choose to deny it, hey, that's not my issue. My point is just to tell you these things. And if you want more, contact me, okay? And we can possibly get some kind of thing going. But this is like the best platform. Well, not the best, but this is one platform that I can use in order to let out a lot of information. So, and then answer your questions, because I've been getting a lot of questions from like literally one video. The reason why I'm making these series is because of one video, the one that I described my freedom in Jesus, being freed of schizophrenia, literally to this day. It's been like almost 3.5 years since in like a couple months, it'll be 3.5 years since I have not taken medication, right? So listen, so when you like either bind stuff by your word or loose stuff by your word, if you're a follower of the one true God, then you can actually see the evidences, right? literally, the curse shall be forever, right? The curse is forever until it's broken, right? These things, they continue on. Now, if you pray, like my community has prayed for killings to stop happening in the youth community, that's fine and all. But y'all just took out basically like the tree and the trunk. That's it. The roots are still there. Somewhere down the line, eventually, generations from now, because the roots were not taken completely out, the tree will regrow, and then people will kill themselves later. I kid you not. People will kill themselves later if the roots are not taken out. Now, the next question is, how do you take out the roots? Well, you need to know what to say. The power is in your tongue, but the source of the power, the source behind the words, is really what it is. Because listen, go research. Warlocks and wizards and witches and people that serve Satan knowingly have spiritual power that the average human being is it just goes over their head. What do you mean you can curse a whole neighborhood? What? You got to understand that this is a spiritual battle. You can't see it. You cannot see the spiritual battle. So when these wizards and witches and warlocks go by the power of Satan to literally curse a whole neighborhood, Do you think you can't see this stuff? You just see the effects of it. Now all of a sudden, so and so and these people are starting to kill each other. Now so and so are doing things to little boys and girls like on like in this region of the area constantly. Now there's sex trafficking. Now there's drug problems. Now there's poverty problems. Now there's murder problems. Now there's this problems. Now marriage problems. Now miscarriages. Now deaths. Now accidents. Now these are literal curses that somebody that knows the source and the reasoning behind it can happen, right? When you say, oh, I hope they go to hell, you're literally cursing someone an eternal curse to be separated from their creator forever once everything is said and done. The books are open and the books close again and everyone gets judged. Listen, okay? The words of God can show light to what you need to say. So now, what are some of the things that can be said, right? First, you have to understand some basic things. There are reasons why Satan is able to stay there. Listen closely. Remember Job. Job could not do, he couldn't do anything until what happened? Until the word was given and he was given what? Permission. He was given permission to go and destroy Job's life up to a certain point that God set the boundary to, right? Now listen, now follow by the words. Right? It was given permission for him to rain destruction. If you actually go read what Satan was able to do, it's mind-blowing. People forget that he does this stuff. They just think that he's just doing, oh, you know, no, you know, like I'm Satan and I, you know, make people feel depressed. There's a lot more than that. He does that too, but he can do a lot more. He's just not trying to be seen, right? So listen. So the permission was given. Once the permission was given, he has free reign. So now if you have a curse in your life, you have given it permission, or somebody in your bloodline has given it permission to be in there with you in your life. Very similar to if a thief had a key to my car and I didn't know. They can drive off anytime they want. They can bring it back anytime they want. They probably won't bring it back, right? But they can go in and out anytime they want. Have a key to my house, a password to my laptop. They can log in anytime they want, right? If they have access, if they have the physical laptop, they can go in and out anytime they want. Right? Unless I change it, right? Unless I change it. So listen, so legal right, right? Legal right. The devil was given legal right to mess with Job's life, right? So scientifically proven, it's shown that your blood holds the memories of all your ancestors, right? The water, literal water, H2O can hold memory. What's in your blood? Water's in your blood, right? And other things. And these things get and where did you get your blood from? Your parents. Where did they get their blood from? Their parents. So generationally speaking, this is scientific. This is science, okay? This is science backing this stuff up. I don't need science to back it up because I have the word of God, right? But listen, so scientifically proven, what is in literally your blood is all your ancestors, their memories and their traumas, right? Scientifically proven. People that had, there was like a Holocaust, like a Holocaust, what's it called? I don't know why I'm blanking. There was a Holocaust study of the descendants of the Holocaust. They were dealing with things that weren't even that stressful, but because the your literal DNA changes, this is baffling stuff. Your literal DNA changes when your ancestors go through traumatic stuff, slavery in America, in South Africa, the genocides and all those people, we have literal DNA change alterations because of what our ancestors went through. We didn't have to go through it. We have it in our blood. Our DNA changed, right? So in this study, the ancestors of the people that directly dealt with the Holocaust were dealing with life, but for some reason, they had high levels of stress, just the same as their ancestors, just the same as their parents' parents or whatever, right? And these are people that never seen the Holocaust happen, but yet they were dealing with, like, they had very similar, like, stress levels to the point of, it was almost identical. They're like, what is this, right? In due time, science finds out that DNA alters when you have traumatic experiences happen and you pass it down. This is another way in the scientific world, biblically speaking, it's a curse, right? That has been passed down. So now we're talking spiritual. If you have something of miscarriages in your blood, because of whatever your ancestors did, in your blood, it's there. Thus, because the curse is still there and hasn't been broken, it has legal right to operate, just as Satan had legal right to operate in Job's life. It has legal right to operate in there until it's broken. Right? Because Satan could do only up to what he was told to do. After he did that, that's all he could do. He couldn't do anything. But it's because Satan is Satan, he's going to operate in every way that he can. Right? So now if you have been given awareness of what you are dealing with, and there's a broad plethora of things, a broad array of curses and things like that that can happen in a person's life. Now, it's not always demonic. It could just be fleshly, right? It's not always, it could just be the world, right? So that's where spiritual discernment has to come in so you can differentiate between them. Like so somebody says like, oh, like, you know, so-and-so is lazy. It must be a demon. Like, no. It's not always like that. Or so-and-so is blind. Like, let's cast out the demon. Sometimes your physical eyes just need to get healed, right? It's not a one-size-fits-all. People being demonized is not the one answer that fits everything. I had to learn this, you know what I'm saying? Like after a year of like casting some demons out, after a couple years of studying, after a year, two, 3 years of going through deliverance myself, I have a much more understanding, much better understanding of the spiritual realm, right? So the legal permission is given through the words, right? So how do you break the legal permission? Renunciation. You renounce these things by your words. It came in by words. It can't leave except by words, right? So you have to renounce these things, right? And this is the power of your words. Literally, listen. The things that is in your blood is from your ancestors. And if your ancestors dealt with something and you still have it in your blood, it's still there. And your kids will have it and their kids will have it. And somewhere down the line, somebody's going to directly deal with it, right? Kind of like if something is dormant and it needs the right catalyst to spark it, right? Let's say there's old bombs. Right? Like, because they have them all over the world, right? Bombs that they just don't use, missiles or bullets that they don't use, right? Like old bullets. Let's just say, for example, right? Bullets been sitting there for 100 years. It's going to sit there for 1,000 more years, but it's never going to go off. Why? Because there wasn't a catalyst, right? Now, all of a sudden, let's say there was a fire, right? And this is a warehouse with a lot of wood in it. Then all of a sudden, all this stuff starts burning. What's going to happen to the bullets? It's going to start, it's going to start shooting, right? Because there's heat and then the, right? It's going to go in whichever direction. Same with bombs, right? If there's a fire or if there's some kind of leak or something that like starts the chain reaction in the bomb, then it's going to explode. Just like the curses, they're dormant, right? Until Satan can use like some kind of catalyst, right? Something to spark it. Maybe you allowed it into it. Maybe you've seen somebody. Maybe Satan is trying to work in your life that you could actually, so he can capitalize on like starting that like curse, right? So then all of a sudden, like for me, all of a sudden, 19 years old, boom, all of a sudden I start hearing voices, I start seeing things, I start talking weird, I start just doing this. I don't even think anything is real. I don't know what the heck is reality anymore. This is all of a sudden, boom, right at 19. I was normal 3 months before. And then 3 months later, oh man, this and this red fire and this fire and this blue fire and red blood and this green blood, like all these weird stuff, right? Like, oh, grandiose thoughts. These are literal things. Satan had to wait until he could capitalize on the perfect moment where I was susceptible to allowing that door to open up, right? But by the grace of God, I've been saved. So now these words, right? They can activate it. They can actually activate it, right? You can literally have somebody that has had generations of people that have like generations, for example, of like people that kind of go into drugs or they are rebellious to parents, but not the normal rebellious, because most teenagers in America are rebellious to parents to some degree, right? More or less, right? Now, I mean like rebellious, like they are like out of control, like they're dishonoring their parents, they're rebellious, they don't care about no authority. I'm talking police, judge, whatever, parents, aunt, uncle, grandpa, they're just reckless, right? And then they have generations of that. That doesn't make any sense. These are curses in your blood. And when you break them in Jesus' name, that's where it stops. And then you speak it. I break this curse in the name of Jesus. Hold on. There's a book that you have to get, okay? Curse Breaking by Bob Larson, right? And it has, it's a super short read, but towards the end, it has a lot of renunciation, right? Like it has like a renunciation, breaking the of false religion, breaking of the curse of destructive emotions, witchcraft, pride, rejection, anger and hate, fear, isolation, depression, self-hatred, and it goes on and on and on, right? This is a very, very good tool to have, and I'm not paid to say any of this. Like, he has an international school of exorcism, and I went through it by experience and by studying with my friend who personally knows Bob Larson, right? So there's a few more books that I'm gonna have to point out in the next videos for you guys to get, but like curses, right? It comes in by words, it goes out by words, right? Like Job was allowed to have destruction reign in his life because God said the word and Satan used what was given to him. You or someone in your life has given reign to Satan. It doesn't have to, you didn't even have to be alive. Literally, right? Like kind of like how some parents dedicate their kids' lives to God, right? They do the same thing, but generations ago, when desperation meets hard times and like there's a way out, like witch doctors, right? Like Africans, a huge portion of the continent of Africa have witch doctors right now active, right? And then they go to those people and they say, okay, do this. And then, you know, you'll have kids or something. But if you have kids, 5 generations from now, X, Y, and Z will happen. Then what happens 5 generations from now? But you don't know. It might be you that you're going to break your leg. And then, you know, it might be like somebody over here got into an accident. And somebody over here did this. And somebody over here did that. Or somebody over here died at a young age. Like there's patterns that happens, right? But these are by words, okay? These agreements, okay? In the spirit realm, this isn't normal talk. This isn't normal human signing a document, okay? This is like a spiritual document where Satan is allowed, legally he can be there until it's broken in the name of Jesus. No other name shall break it because demons tremble at the name of Jesus. Like it's literally a thing. When you start casting demons out of people and you say that, like you feel the fear inside the demon. It's crazy, man. It's crazy, but it's real though. So these are the things that I need you guys to understand. There's a lot more to this, okay? There's a lot. The International School of Exorcism by Bob Larson, is literally hours and hours and hours and hours long. So for me to try to condense these in 30-minute little sessions is gonna be tough, okay? So eventually, I will, you know, once I get to that point, I will actually extend, like, go through, like, things step by step in the way that I see it, right? And in the method that I use, because you can say that I am a deliverance minister, I guess, right? Whatever. This is something Jesus told every Christian to do, right? So in the name of Jesus is how you can break and renounce these things and break the legal right that they have to be there through your words, though. You have to say it, right? And there's a lot more to it, but... yeah, so this is part two of the your words of spiritual warfare. Yeah.